All right, let's turn to Jeremiah 31. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them, even unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Gracious God, we ask thy benediction as we travel further down the historical road of covenant theology, as we enter the broad and deep field of the Puritans. We pray for insight, for guidance, for benediction, for clarity. And we ask, Lord, that thy blessing would rest upon the lectures tonight. So be with us now, we pray, and bless us in every way for Jesus' sake. Amen. I should have mentioned to you this afternoon that this morning I put a new outline on the populi. It's more detailed. I'm not sure you all got that. Did you all get that? Okay, great. All right, so we're up to Olivianus. We've seen a number of approaches to covenant. Probably the most heartwarming this afternoon was, at least for me, was Theodore Beza. And remarkable because he's just exactly the one who's accused of being cold and distant. So we're going to look at Olivianus for maybe 15 minutes here, and then we're going to move into the Puritans, and we'll look at the Puritans on the covenant of works tonight, and hopefully get through also the Puritans on the covenant of redemption. And if we do really well, we'll start Puritans on the covenant of grace, but that'll probably be Wednesday. We already looked at Olivianus, how he got to Heidelberg. Olivianus was just a tremendously warm person and able theologian, very much the opposite of the character of Ursinus. You know, Ursinus had a sign above his door that said, friend, you're welcome here, but basically be quick because I've got a lot of work to do. I don't know exactly how it said in Latin, but don't stay very long. He was not a people person. Olivianus was. And so they made a good combination. Olivianus presents his view of the covenant of grace, particularly in his exposition of the Apostles' Creed. And there's three basic things to say about it. It's Christ-centered, it's Trinitarian, and it's relational. Christ-centered, Trinitarian, and relational. He begins by saying that there are two spiritual kingdoms and that everyone belongs to either the kingdom of Satan or the kingdom of Christ. And Christ gathers his subjects by calling them effectually through his word. And the administration of this kingdom of Christ, he writes, is that new covenant which Jeremiah prophesies of in Jeremiah 31. It's a covenant ratified by Christ's own merit as the priest of his people. So like the other writers we've been seeing, he says, it does not rest upon any condition of our own worthiness or merit, but it's received through faith alone. A faith which God grants us when the Holy Spirit causes us to desire to believe and to be able to believe. So there again, you see right away the monopleric character, the one-sided character of the covenant and its initiation. Olivianus then goes on to say that there's no form more fitting, these are his words, more fitting than a covenant for this arrangement of reconciliation. For he says, after great hostilities, people are finally pacified in their minds when they are mutually bound to each other with promises and oaths to embrace peace. And so he says, God uses this form of a covenant to have a relationship with us in order to, quote, quiet our consciences. Quiet our consciences. So that we might be certain and assured of a lasting, eternal peace and friendship between God and us through his son's sacrifice. Now, I find that a beautiful expression. The Puritans actually pick up on that expression. They often spoke about the importance of having a quiet conscience, that you have an inward peace. And when you are responding in the covenant, responding with obedience, desiring to do God's will, despite your shortcomings, and you fly to Christ with your sins, you can live a quiet and peaceful life in your conscience because you're at peace with God through the blood of his son. That's a beautiful way to live. In this covenant, God then binds himself by a solemn oath to adopt us as his cleansed and renewed children and binds us to trust and to glorify his triune name. So he contracts the covenant with us. We respond with covenant faithfulness. So this is how he sees the entire Apostles' Creed. Isn't that interesting? He says the first part of the creed is God the Father revealing himself, quote, as the first fountain of the covenant of reconciliation. The second part of the creed is Jesus Christ, who covers the whole summary of the covenant. The third part of the creed is the Holy Spirit, who makes us, quote, covenant partners with God. And the fourth part is about the people with whom God makes this covenant, that is, the church. So if you grasp this rightly, think of the Apostles' Creed, Father, Son, Spirit, Church, and you put beside it, fountain of covenant, summary of covenant, covenant partners, and then covenant people, the church. And the Apostles' Creed is a summary of all the basic core beliefs of the Christian faith. Now you understand, Olivianus is actually giving us the framework of how we can do an entire systematic theology around the theme of covenant, which, of course, is later done by Herman Witsius in the kind of Dutch/English tradition, and by Coxeus. We'll talk about that. It's not really a full systematics. But this is a structuring principle under which you can bring all theology, covenant. And then when you come into it by faith, when you enter into that covenant by faith, we become covenant partners with the triune God through the covenant of faith that is sealed with the seal of baptism. Olivianus then says, well, who really enters into this covenant? Well, the whole visible church is under the administration of the covenant. But only the elect receive the substance of the covenant. Here again, we're getting into this outward-inward theme, right? The whole visible church is under the administration of the covenant. Only the elect receive the substance of the covenant in its spiritual graces. So the kingdom of Christ is made up of repentant believers and their children. Quote, unless when they are grown through unbelief, they reject the benefit that's offered. So for Olivianus, the covenant is bound up in the experiential knowledge of the covenant God. We get to know him and cling to him in covenant relationship. And this is the highest good of all of life. When God, in a covenant relationship, communicates himself to us through the knowledge of himself. And so then he enters a long section, of course, where he talks about what it is for us to know God as our Father, to know Jesus Christ as our Savior, and to know the Holy Spirit. He says, when we know the Father, we covenant with him as our Creator and as our Father, and we cheerfully do his will. And the doctrine of providence enables us to trust him as a faithful covenant partner of God. See, it's all relational for Olivianus. And then he speaks about our relationship with Christ, how to know him. In God's Son, all of God's promises are yea and amen. And God forgives our sins through trust in Christ's sacrifice. That's the same in the Old Covenant. Through trust in the coming future sacrifice of Christ, we now in the sacrifice of Christ that is behind us. So again, the Old Covenant. Scott Clark, by the way, from Westminster, did his doctoral dissertation on Olivianus, and Lyle Beerman has done a lot of work on him. Scott Clark says the Old Covenant, speaking, of course, of Olivianus, was the Mosaic Covenant, the national temporary typological covenant that God made with national Israel. And that national thing is important. I will come back in several different Puritans, and particularly in the Dutch tradition, that the covenant, the Mosaic Covenant, first and foremost needs to be understood as a national covenant with a national people, Israel. And then he goes on, Scott Clark goes on to say, for Olivianus, the new covenant remains an expression of the Abrahamic covenant. What has changed is the administration of the promise, not the promise itself. That is not true of all the people we're considering, but it is true of some. They see, like Brockle too, sees the Mosaic covenant as a national covenant. The Abrahamic covenant is the one that's more directly related to the covenant of grace, only with different emphases, of course, now. Others don't make that distinction and see every covenant from the covenant with Noah all the way through as just being one string of the covenant of grace. Olivianus goes on to say that we get to know Christ as the mediator of the covenant through his offices. He speaks then for a while, I won't go into that detail, but about Christ, knowing Christ as prophet, knowing Christ as priest, knowing Christ as king, lovely section. And then he comes to the Holy Spirit, and he says that we get to know the Spirit as well through his work in us. And the Spirit brings us then into fellowship with the triune God, but also into fellowship with the people of God, so that we have koinonia. We have fellowship with the triune God and with the people of God. So this covenant is relational both vertically and horizontally. And then he concludes by saying, the grace of the covenant comes to us in a double benefit promised in Jeremiah 31. First, that God writes his law in our hearts so that by his Spirit he begins a new obedience in us. And then that he remembers, secondly, our sins no more. He says, where these two things are present, that is where God writes his law in our hearts and we get this new obedience, and where he forgives all our sins, there's a solid friendship and a sure and everlasting covenant. And we have a relationship of grace here that will turn into a relationship of eternal friendship and glory hereafter in glory. Okay, so those are a few thoughts about Olivianus. Any questions there? All right, let's get to the meat of the course, the Puritans. And I'm going to walk you through some basics, and then we'll go a bit deeper. So first, some introduction. The Puritans teach us that when we begin to think of God making a covenant with man, there will be some particular distinctives. So I'm moving now, if you've got the outline in front of you, to 4A1, distinctives about divine covenants. The first distinctive is that God is and will be in every way unique in that covenant. And he will be infinitely superior in that covenant to every other covenant made between men. Because, after all, in God we live and move and have our being. So the fact that he enters into covenant with us is something very, very special. I was talking with a young man not so long ago, and he said he's going after a young girl and asked my advice, and he thought he was shooting too high. Said didn't think he could ever get her. But she said yes. She began a relationship with him, and parents are okay on both sides. So he said to me, I'm just so overwhelmed. He said, she's so much better than I am. I'm just so grateful even to be able to begin this relationship. Well, how must a Christian feel? Enter into a relationship with the God of the universe, and I've rebelled against him? This is unique. This is glorious. Puritans emphasize that a lot. The wonder of it. The wonder of a relationship, a friendship with the Almighty. Secondly, the Puritans say that men do not have the liberty to take it or to leave it. Because this is the divine covenant. In a human covenant, you know, you make agreements every day with people. To take it or to leave it, or do it or not, but not here. The Puritans want to focus on this, that God doesn't ask us to enter into covenant with us. God takes the initiative, and he does it. And we, of course, we acquiesce. It'd be crazy not to. How could you not acquiesce with God? But what the Puritans are saying is something even stronger, that in our human nature, or in Adam, for example, pre-fall, it would have been impossible for Adam not to have said yes. And And they draw on texts like Psalm 111, verse 9, which says, God has commanded his covenant forever. Thirdly, in this divine covenant, the Puritans say, another unique thing is that God doesn't come to discuss with us the nature of the conditions. In other words, there's no negotiation. God doesn't say, you know, I was thinking about this covenant that we're going to enter into, and I was thinking about these conditions. How do they sound to you? Puritans really focus here on 2 Samuel 23, verse 5, where David says, he's made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things, and sure, for this is all my salvation, all my desire, although he make it not to grow. And you know, it's a wonderful thing. Sometimes a child, an obedient child, just thinks it's a wonderful thing if dad just takes over and tells him what this is going to be like, or what's going to happen. And in the believer's life, it's comforting to know that God sets the conditions. It's actually a blessing. Knowing my depravity, it's a blessing that I don't have to negotiate with God. I trust him more than I trust myself. I know his conditions are going to be good and fair and kind. Fourthly, a divine covenant is unique in that benefits do not accrue to God. That doesn't mean to say that God doesn't get joy out of the relationship, but in other words, we cannot make God something more than what he is. We cannot glorify him more than he's already glorified when we enter into covenant with him. This is an amazing covenant. Romans 11:35-36 says, who hath first given to him, and it shall be recompensed unto him again? For of him and through him and to him are all things, to him be glory forever. Fifthly, this covenant is unique in that we're not just talking about outward mutual benefits or outward obligations and responsibilities, but this is a covenant of spirituality. There's a heart element in this covenant. God is a spirit. Those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. And so essentially it's a spiritual covenant. It's an experiential covenant. Jeremiah 31:33. After those days, saith the Lord, I put my law in their inward parts. So this bond of union and communion with God himself, this close, precious relationship, is embedded deep in the inner soul of the believer. And that makes it a very special covenant indeed. And you can see where Beza, from that perspective, developed that whole paradigm of marital relationship. Because of the marital bond, you love your spouse, your would-be spouse, with the depths of your soul. So in this covenant, you love God even more. Okay, so those are five distinctives about divine covenants that make them very, very special. Now let me say that another important thought we need to nail down right at the beginning when we discuss the Puritan view of covenant is that the God of this covenant is really what it's all about. It's all about him, not about us. He's the center. He's glorious. And it's part of his character, part of his very nature. Well, I wouldn't even say part. It's who God is. God is a covenant God. So his very, very, very special name, all his names are very special, but a very, very special name is Yahweh. And what is Yahweh? A faithful, covenant-keeping God who was what he was, is what he is, shall be what he shall be, the I Am. The I Am is a covenant-keeping God. And so there are a number of points to make here about this, the God of the covenant. First, the Puritans stress that there's a covenant bond from eternity within the Holy Trinity among the three persons of the sacred Godhead. There's a delight among these three persons. Proverbs 8, verse 30 speaks of wisdom personified, and it speaks of the Father delighting in the Son delighting in the Father. That's all throughout the Bible. The Son is overall God blessed forevermore, Romans 9 says. We'll have opportunity later in this course to talk more about how there's this mutual intra-Trinitarian delight. But it's important to understand that covenant relationship has its roots, first of all, within the equality of the Trinity itself. Secondly, God, the God of the covenant, delights to make himself known as Yahweh, Jehovah. God loves to make his name known as the God of the covenant. How many times do you think the word Jehovah, or in the King James Version, Lord with the O-R-D in smaller caps, how many times do you think it's used in the Old Testament? Anybody want to hazard a guess?
700?
Yeah, that's about what I would have guessed, 700. 6,823.
Yes.
Isn't that phenomenal? It's everywhere. God says, I am Yahweh, a covenant-keeping God. And so, in Exodus 3:14, where God says to Moses, I am that I am, and then in Exodus 6:3, by my name Jehovah was I not known to them. These are very, very foundational verses in the Old Testament, verses of self-revelation. The third point here that we need to say about the heart of this God of covenant is I just need to comment about the word chesed. In Hebrew, a very important word describing God, and a hard word to translate into any language. Sometimes translated as a merciful God, sometimes translated as a kind God, sometimes translated as a God of loving kindness. That's probably the best translation. But it's really all of this wrapped up in one. And often the Bible focuses on the eternal quality of chesed. His mercy endureth forever. This is the God of loving kindness, that is the God of the covenant. Psalm 36:10 says, O, continue thy loving kindness unto them that love me, that know me, know thee. So the root Hebrew word here appears to mean steadfastness, kindness, and, for lack of a better term, eagerness, all rolled into one in the context of covenant. Meaning that God is going to show his people a sense of allegiance, a sense of loyalty, kind loyalty, that is absolutely unmatchable by anything in this world. Even on a human level, David and Jonathan did this, didn't they? In 1 Samuel 20, you know, they had this special friendship that even the Bible says was even closer than the friendship of a husband and wife, of course, without any homosexual tendencies. And this 1 Samuel 20:14-16 says, Thou shalt not only while yet I live show me the chesed of the Lord, that I die not, but also thou shalt not cut off thy chesed from my house forever. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David. This is a mercy. This is a bond of friendship that you just can't bind up in any human words. This is the God of covenant. And it's interesting that one scholar says that this word, chesed, is used most particularly in Scripture and most repetitively in relationship to the divine covenant. Psalm 89 is a wonderful example for you to study, as is Deuteronomy 7. Edmund Jacob, former professor at the University of Strasbourg, says, we can define chesed as the power which guarantees a covenant and then makes that covenant strong and durable. The Puritan emphasis was, chesed belongs to God. It is who he is. Psalm 62 says, verse 12, also unto thee, O Lord, belongeth chesed. And the amazing thing about God's covenant, the Puritans said, is that this chesed, this loving kindness, is committed to thousands. Jeremiah 32:18, thou showest thy chesed unto thousands. So God is generous not only by giving his chesed, but he is giving it to multitudes no man can number. This is the God of covenant. This is the God we serve. This is the God we must preach. You know, my family, well, my wife grew up in the NRC background, and I did as well. And if you had asked me when I was a boy, what's really the essence, what's really the heart of God, I'm sure I would have said justice. When I married my wife, that's the way she felt, and it held her in bondage for a while, that she couldn't really see that God was a God of chesed, a God of mercy. And then I preached a sermon one time on Micah 7:18, to thee, O Lord, belongeth mercy. And God used that to break through in her life. You see, this is so important to understand. So important for your future congregations to understand. This is the very heartbeat of God. It's just mercy, oh, of course. But it's chesed, loyalty. God does not forsake the work of his own hands. And what a comfort that is. What a comfort. Fourthly, the Puritans make a good deal of this, that God, as an intelligent being, has a will. And so he wills this covenant. This is what he delights in. And his election, his sovereign election, is really the initial act of this chesed, this covenant faithfulness, by which he moves toward establishing relationship with people, with sinners. And so in that election, he loves people with this kind of chesed love, with an everlasting love. And therefore, as a result of electing eternal love, in time he enters into this covenant friendship with his people that resembles the friendship of an ideal marriage. Puritan John Trapp said it rather beautifully. He's one of those Puritans that are really quaint. You know, some Puritans have long, long sentences. Some are very short and they're very witty. Well, Trapp is one of those. And he says, God first chose his love, and then he loved his choice. I will betroth thee unto me forever, saith the Lord, in faithfulness. And thou shalt know the Lord. John Gerstner says, the covenant of grace is nothing other than the way by which God decrees to carry out what he committed himself to do. He's already bound by his own decree. This covenant can bind him no tighter, but it binds him more specifically. That is, it binds him with respect to a particular plan for particular people, which he's imposed upon himself. Point five, the divine titles, which God assumes for himself, are titles that evidence him to be a God determined to covenant. And there are many titles that could be looked at here, but there's just not enough time to really expound on them. You know them, I'm sure. One of the most precious titles is the Shepherd of Israel. Everything a shepherd does for sheep, God does all that and more. And that's a glorious title that shows his covenant loyalty. Another title, of course, is husband. Isaiah 54, Hosea 3. God exercises his sovereign will. And there's mystery here, of course, because there's infinite distance between him and us. But he's willed to bestow love upon us. Love that is free. As Thomas Brooks said, love that is free, that is sweet, that is faithful, and love in which he delights in us. So the Lord is our husband, we are his wife, and he says in Hosea 2, I will betroth thee unto me forever in righteousness and in judgment and in chesed and in mercies. I will even betroth thee unto me in faithfulness, and thou shalt know the Lord. Sixthly, there are certain attributes of God that are just intimately bound up in covenant concept. And one is the perfection of goodness. Exodus 34, verse 6 says he's abundant in goodness. We make a distinction between his absolute goodness and his relative goodness. His absolute goodness is the goodness of his nature, which cannot be imparted to others. But his relative goodness is the goodness which he freely bestows upon sinners. Psalm 119, verse 68, thou art good and thou doest good, teach me thy statutes. And it's that goodness that enables, that relative goodness that enables God to enter into relationship with us so that we taste his goodness and reflect that goodness back to him. William Strong, who I mentioned earlier, wrote this great book on covenant, said this, I will be thy God and thou shalt be my people. These are the words of the promise in which the main of the covenant of God's goodness lies on God's part. This is his goodness. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And Strong says, God in the sacredness of all three persons is then made over to us. The goodness of God is made over to us. The Father is made over to us to know us. The Son is made over us to redeem us. The Spirit is made over us to comfort us. And he goes on to say, the very nature of God is made over to us. His eternity is made over to us. His power is made over to us. And then he says, his relations are made over to us. The believer can say of God in Christ, this is my friend and this is my beloved. God makes over himself to us so much that he cannot give any more to us. There is nothing more that God can bestow upon the children of men but himself. And he does this when he establishes covenant with us. And then finally, his divine words and his divine works are made over to us. His precious word, the scriptures, and his works of providence, his wonderful works, by which he makes himself known to the children of men. They become ours. And through his words and works, he reveals and grants his goodness to us. The seventh and the last point I'll make about the God of the covenant right now is that in this covenant, God always aims at his own eternal glory. This is a huge Puritan emphasis. What's the chief end of man? Puritan emphasis. Glorify God and enjoy him forever. What covenant language that is. That's the goal. The Lord hath made all things for himself, Proverbs 16, verse 4. At the end of Romans 11, the words that made Benjamin Warfield cry out that no one could say this but a true Calvinist. For of him, and through him, and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. That must always be true of God. And the covenant relationship helps work that out. God cannot have an unworthy or a dishonorable end to a relationship with any one of his children. What a beautiful thing that is. Here in this life, things are imperfect. David said, my own familiar friend hath lifted up his heel against me. One of the greatest trials you'll ever face in the ministry, my dear brother, is when a dear child of God is a dear friend turns against you. What a trial that is. But God is saying, this will never happen with me. I aim at my glory, and I don't fail in any of my relationships. I am perfect. I am Yahweh. I am Chesed. My godliness and my holiness come together in me. I'm the God of the covenant. You know, several of the Puritans, when they define covenant, they bring these two words together, swearing and fidelity, somewhere in their definition. They say covenant is God's sworn fidelity, sworn faithfulness to his people. I will be their God. I swear by myself. That's covenant language. Verily, verily, I say unto you, I will be your God, and you shall be my people. So, this glorious God of the covenant sees to it that the covenant is God-centered. He sees to it that he has one plan of salvation, and that plan will be fulfilled. He sees to it that he'll fulfill that covenant in the hearts of his people. It's an experiential covenant. And through this covenant relationship, God builds the confidence of his people so that they find all their security in him. And through that, he builds his church, builds assurance of faith into his own, builds his church to 1,000 generations until the day comes that all believers will enjoy the same consummate experience in the eternal state in which we will sit down with the Lord Jesus Christ as well as with saints like Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of God and have a direct and satisfying knowledge of one another, said one Puritan, even of those whose existence we've never known till meeting there, without one needing to inquire concerning another who he is, there will be a perfect knowledge, ravishing, inexhaustible themes of discourse they will thus have in heaven about all God's gracious words and works and wonders, and about the persons in the eternal Godhead. What a glorious future for the covenant people of God, with God and with one another. Salvation to God and to the Lamb forever and forever. Now this is just a few words about the God of the covenant that the Puritans would present to us. Now, thirdly, we want to look at this theme here that I've outlined called the importance of the one God, one covenant, one people concept. For God, what he does is he brings together all of his people under one covenant to serve the one God forever and forever. And as I've just been hinting at, that when the God of the covenant draws you in allegiance to his fidelity and you respond to his faithfulness, the beauty of it all is that the millions and millions of people around the globe of all ages who enter into this personal relationship with God all worship exactly the same God, one God, and through the same covenant, and thus they become one people. And that mystic union, also between the people of God, is something that the Puritans focus a great deal on. And sometimes focus on it to a point that might make some of us feel uncomfortable. Not all of Puritans do this, but some of them really wax a little bit mystical here. You think of Isaac Ambrosi. He talks about communing here on earth with saints in glory and even with angels in glory. That's never happened to me. And I'm not sure quite what to make of it sometimes. But there is such, and that's not the majority of Puritans, but there was such an emphasis on this fellowship theme and this interrelationship theme, not only between God and his people, but between his people and his people as a fruit of this covenant relationship, that you need to understand how this richness of covenant in Puritan thought bonded people to people. And today, when you experience a little of this internationally, it's a very gripping concept. I'll never forget traveling all the way across the world, the very opposite side of the world, in New Zealand, my first trip to New Zealand, and an evangelist picking me up from the airport there. And before we were even out of the airport, I mean, we were driving out, but we were out. We were still within the boundaries of the airport. I could say, I love this brother. we were already sharing each other's conversion and identifying with each other. It was just a bond on the other side of the world. I didn't know this guy whatsoever before. And within 10 minutes, bam, you just felt like you knew him for years. And that's a common experience, and it's a beautiful experience, especially when you go cross-cultural. I mean, this is what you guys experience, coming from so many different countries here. You're sitting in one room. You love the same Savior. You're bonded together by the same truths. And incredibly different cultures, different concepts, different ideas in your background, different foods, different everything. But this bonds you together. That's a beautiful thing. All right. It also works throughout the ages, you know, this concept. You know, Luther said, most of my best friends are dead. They're people that I read in the books. They become very close to me throughout the ages. And I've had that a lot in my life. I'm sure you've had it as well. But books have been probably the most important means of grace in my life, actually. And I just get so bonded sometimes to an author reading them, even though he's gone for hundreds of years. And it's amazing how when you read the old divines, how they connect with you theologically, personally, experientially, practically. And then all of a sudden you come up against something that, like, where in the world does that come from? Because they lived in a different age, a different culture. It's so far out of the realm of your experience. But everything about the Lord, everything about his relationship with the Lord bonds. You know, I had this when I was editor of the four volumes of Brockle's Christian's Reasonable Service. I love those books. I love that man so much through those books. You know, you think you work 6 years on a project, you'd be glad to have it done. I was sorry to finish it. I was really sorry to finish it. But I got in the middle of, I think it's volume three now, maybe volume two. And all of a sudden, I read this statement. Well, anybody knows, of course, that the sun revolves around the earth, not the earth around the sun. And anyone who thinks differently is just a blockhead. Absolutely stupid beyond all measure. And I'm reading this and saying, this is written 300 years ago. And Brockle is so far off base in this particular statement. But everything else he says is just wonderful. There's a bonding theologically, and areas are very different. So that, like when you guys get together too now, I mean, you may have some different cultures. So how can he do that? How can he believe that? How can he like that food? But when it comes to Christ, bonding. Isn't there something beautiful about that? Then when you have the infallible Bible, you think about this here. You can't read through Brockle without having something jump out of you that is just not true whatsoever. 300 years ago. What about when you read the Bible over thousands of years and you can't find anything in the inspired scriptures that jumps out at you that way because there's no mistakes? What a beautiful thing Christianity is and covenant is. What a bonding there is among the people of God. We have, as Spurgeon put it, we have bonds with one another that the world knows nothing about. So the covenant is a bonding thing. Now, fourthly, there are differences of God's covenants with men from people's covenants with each other. Puritans focus on that as well. The first thing is that the God who makes the covenant and the parties who are covenanting are not equal. The Puritan Patrick Gillespie, who, by the way, wrote two whole books on covenanting, Covenant of Works, the Covenant of Grace, says this: absolute superiority and inferiority is between God and his creature. Absolute superiority and absolute inferiority. So the parties aren't equal. The second difference is that God only is the author of such a covenant. And he's always pleased to propound the covenant. The superior party initiates and the inferior party acquiesces. Thirdly, God's sovereignty is expressed in the imposition of the covenant. That's what I was saying about no negotiation. Man does not have the liberty or freedom to refuse it. Fourthly, the promises of a divine covenant are incapable of being offered by a man. You know, we can promise each other different things, but only God can promise what he has promised to give in the covenant, all the benefits of salvation. And finally, the divine covenant always redounds to God's glory. Francis Roberts says this, God by his covenant displays his glory most gloriously. Herein shines the glory of free grace, the glory of his wisdom in contriving it, the glory of his goodness, mercy, and loving kindness, condescending and stooping to mere men, and that so familiarly in a covenant way, glory of his liberty in exacting whom, when, where, and upon what terms he pleases into a covenant with himself, rejecting also at his pleasure the glory of his justice and faithfulness in performing exactly all the promises and threats of the covenant in their reason and in their season, and the glory of his power in enabling his people acceptably to perform covenant with him to the end. Bam, that's all in one sentence. Glory, 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 glory. And he's relating it to every attribute. So much for the rule today that we're not supposed to have more than 15 words in a sentence. Puritans had like 50 words in the title of a book. All right, so those are some introductory comments. Any questions on those? Yes. Yeah.
Speak to that, condescension and
yeah. They don't always use the same words that Calvin used in terms of accommodation and condescension, and they don't always have the same imagery of Calvin that God condescends low to us in order to pick us up and to bring us up into heavenly places. But there's nothing contradictory to that, certainly. And the essence of the superiority and the inferiority and that whole, the sense of wonder that God would ever do this is every bit as strong in the Puritans as in Calvin. Proper with the Puritans. And first of all, point B, proofs for God's covenant with Adam. First proof. The Puritans would say that Adam was already under the necessary law of creation. That is, the necessary law of creation, that he was created in the image and likeness of God. So, I won't trouble you with all these quotes because it's pretty basic stuff that is germane to Reformed theology. Those two basic proof texts, the Puritans use those over and over and over again. We're created in the image of God in knowledge, righteousness, and holiness. And so the framework, the moral framework for entering into a covenant was there, was present in the image of God that was given to man. And the concept of law was germane to that image, righteousness. But what gets introduced here in Genesis 2, 16 and 17 was that God is saying, if you obey the law, if you fulfill my condition, then I will bless you with life. If you disobey, you will die. So this is, you see, what makes it a covenant. Because we have in Genesis 2 what we don't have in Genesis 1, namely a conditional promise. So we have in Adam the fact that he has the necessary law of creation within himself. But then we have in Genesis 2 the actual language of God coming and entering into covenant. Secondly, whatever we're going to call this covenant, it is obvious, the Puritans said, that something was established in Genesis 2. Because 16, 17 say, and the Lord God commanded the man. In the original, you can actually read it, the Lord God commanded upon the man. The Lord God commanded upon the man. The Hebrew idea here is that something is set up. Something God is doing something. He's confirming something. He's building something. Again, it's the idea of Psalm 111, verse 9. He hath commanded his covenant forever. He's introduced it. He's confirmed it. He's made it good forever. The third reason to believe that a covenant of works is established in this text, Genesis 2, 16, 17, is that God appeared in this transaction no longer as a mere lawgiver issuing a command, but now there's an implied promise of reward. So we don't have a bare command here in Genesis 2, 16, 17, but we have a bare command with promise. A promise that means that if the condition is fulfilled, God is obliged to do something. And that's the language of covenant. Anthony Burgess, who wrote a great Puritan book on the law that touches often on the covenant, says this: God was not bound to give Adam eternal life if Adam did obey, seeing he owed obedience to God under the title of a creature. But it was of God's mere goodness to become engaged in a promise for us. And that is, of course, what makes it to be a covenant. You understand that? God could say, Adam, you owe this to me, and there's no need for me to reward you. But now God comes and says, I will reward you for obeying me, and I've given you the ability to obey, and I'm obliged to reward you if you obey. That's covenant language. Fourth, Puritans were fond of saying, although the covenant of works was not specifically mentioned in Genesis 2 in terms of name, just like Trinity is not mentioned by name anywhere in the Bible. They would often use that as an example, by the way. All the elements of covenant establishment are found here. And if you compare the arrangements with other covenants in the Scripture, it's all here. So if you take the Abrahamic covenant in Genesis 17, God says, I'm the Almighty God, walk before me, be thou perfect. Well, there's the covenantal obligation. Be thou perfect. Followed by the covenantal promise, and I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. So you have a command, followed by a promise. But that's exactly what you have in Genesis 2. That's exactly what you have in the covenant with Noah, the covenant with David. So we have a covenant arrangement in Genesis 2 with a covenant head and representative, Adam, and there'll be consequences upon Adam's obedience or disobedience. Number five, Puritans also make a great deal out of the fact that just as with other covenants, there are certain tokens or signs, or as they often call it, not all of them, but most of them, sacraments attached. So what's the sign given in the Noahic covenant? Well, the rainbow in the sky. What's the sign given to the Abrahamic covenant? Circumcision. What's the sign given to the Adamic covenant? The tree of life. Some even say the tree of knowledge of good and evil in a negative way. But the tree of life in particular is a sign and seal of the promise of God. And then finally, the last reason for believing a covenant works was established in Genesis 2 is that other texts in the Bible seem to reflect that that is so. And did Dr. Bilkus go into Hosea 6 verse 7 at all with you about they like man? Huh?
We did 6, 6, and then I saw it right below and asked him about it. He's like, yep, that's one that gets brought up a lot.
Okay.
Okay,
okay. They, like man, have transgressed the covenant. The Puritans often in their writings will talk about that because Adam can also be Adam. And the other three places it's used, I believe it's three places. I'm talking off the top of my head now, and that's always dangerous. In the Old Testament, it is translated Adam. And in the Dutch Bible and several other translations, it's translated Adam. King James surprisingly translates it, they like man have transgressed the covenant. That too is true, of course, but there's really no reason not to translate it Adam, most of the Puritans would say. And that's a very, that would, you know, be a clinching text with given all the other support, and particularly the Romans 5 support of the two different covenant heads compared with each other. Now, for every Puritan that I've ever read, Romans 5, 12 to 19 is the mainstay. It's pretty hard to read Romans 5, 12, 19 and deny the historicity of Adam and to deny a covenant with Adam of some sort, no matter what you call it. And so the Puritans would say this, okay, covenant of works is not mentioned by name in Genesis 2, but you've got all this support of Hosea 6. You've got some support in Psalm 89. You've got support in Romans 5, big time. Therefore, we conclude it is a covenant. And there are other places where there are obvious covenants. God obviously made a covenant with David, confirmed it other places. But in 2 Samuel 7, where the covenant is actually made, the word covenant doesn't exist there either. So, this is not unusual. Now, you can call it a covenant of life. You can call it a covenant of works. You can call it a covenant of nature. And there's Puritans that called it all those things and more. But most of them settled on covenant of works, and that's become the established name because the stipulation was that a certain work would be done and certain work would not be done. So works featured largely in God's disclosure to Adam. All right. Any questions? Why don't we take a 10-minute break right here, and then we'll come back in at 20 after. Okay? C, 4C, on the outline. Differences between dealing by way of law and by way of covenant. I'm going to be very brief here because a few of the points have been reflected in other sections, so I don't need to repeat myself, but I just want to give you a list of things the Puritans came up with here. What they're looking at then is that God deals with man by way of a law, as in Genesis 1, for example, and he deals with him by way of a covenant, for example, as in Genesis 2. And what are the differences between these two? Well, number one, God in covenant always humbles himself to deal with man in a special way. God in covenant always humbles himself to deal with man in a special way. That's not the way of law. God, there's no divine accommodation in that way. Number two, covenant demonstrates not so much God's supremacy and power over man, as law does, but rather it demonstrates God's chesed and his love, his kindness and his love. Number three, a third difference between dealing by way of law and by way of covenant, the Puritans said, is that covenant puts great honor upon man. Not in a sinful way, but in an honorable way. It shows divine regard for man and advances him to a position of great privilege, which the law never does. Psalm 8, verse 4 says, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And that's particularly true when we stand before a covenant-keeping God. Who in the world are we that God would enter into covenant with us? Fourthly, although enjoined by God as with the law, a covenant is an agreement. And that too is unique. Fifthly, a covenant is more binding to obedience. It, when there's a covenant, you feel a deeper commitment to obey, which is an asset. Sixthly, the Puritans said, there isn't a covenant, which is not so in the law, the principle of reward, to reward faithfulness and obedience. Although normally obedience has no right to be recompensed, it does in a covenant relationship. And seventhly, usually there are tokens or signs in a covenant that strengthen the covenant, affirm the covenant. I'm talking now about the tree of life and those kinds of things, sacraments. So those are seven ways in which the Puritans said God deals differently by way of law and by way of covenant. Seven things that make covenants just a bit more special. Now, what's much more important here is that we talk about the parties in the covenant, the parties. And obviously, you know already the parties are the Lord God, the Lord using the caps, the Jehovah God, the Yahweh God, and Adam, the man. This God, this Lord God, is the God who is altogether lovely, the God who cannot sin, the God who cannot deny his faithfulness. But the Puritan emphasis here in the Lord God is this concept of loyal friendship. Loyal friendship. In fact, some Puritans even called covenants of friendship. So there's such a loveliness in the being of God that through his covenant establishment with his people, he makes himself so lovable so that you just have this great reverence for him and you want to obey him. And that comes out already in the covenant of works, according to the Puritans. He's God all-sufficient. He's God all-kind. He's God all-knowing. He's God all-everything that is good. He shines forth, says one Puritan, arrayed in robes of ineffable glory in the covenant, the object of all love and obedience, the mighty potentate, the rewarder of righteousness. Were we, my friends, duly enlightened, here we would dwell with submissive astonishment on the character of Jehovah as suited, most suited to this important transaction. We should be ready to cry out, O man, take heed to thy ways. How should it ever once enter into thy thoughts to revolt against such a God or to do any evil in his sight? This makes you reflect again on the marriage relationship, doesn't it? The difference between living common law with someone and living in marriage where you sign a paper, you enter into an oath and a covenant. And you say, as you experience the love of your spouse, I'm so glad I entered into this covenant with you. How can I ever sin against you? How can I be faithless? How could I ever commit adultery against you? You're so lovely. But now imagine being married to a perfect God, being betrothed to the spotless one. Surely we should say every time we're tempted to sin, how can I do this great wickedness, sin against God, like Joseph? You see, that's what led Stephen Charnock, who did the best work ever done in the history of mankind on the attributes of God, say, under the attribute of goodness, every time we sin, we are acting as if God is not. We're being practical atheists, he's saying. Because if you really were aware, immediately in the moment where you chose to sin, of God's presence with you as a covenant-keeping God to whom you owe all allegiance, it's like committing adultery, any sin. So God is one party in this covenant, a glorious party. The other party is, of course, man. In the original paradise, we appeared as someone with a living soul, someone with understanding of our duty, someone with affection to God, who revealed his duty, or reveal our duty to us, and gave us a will to obey him. Nehemiah Cox, in his Discourse on the Covenant, says, Adam was not so confirmed in grace that he could not sin or die, but he was endued with that power and rectitude of nature as that he might not have sinned nor ever died. Wilhelmus Brockle says, Adam was perfect, and therefore, since God could rightfully command and Adam desired to render perfect obedience, he could not refuse, he could not do otherwise than to accept the condition and the promise. So, here you have a perfect God establishing a covenant with a perfect man. God representing all three persons of the Trinity and man representing all mankind, both standing as a head. So Adam is not just our first father, the Puritans said, but he stands as our representative. And then they went out to prove that. Let me give you a couple thoughts. Number one, while the word Adam sometimes refers to an individual, as repeatedly in Genesis 2. Sometimes it refers to mankind as a whole. When God says in Genesis 1:26, let us make man, Adam, and let them have dominion, etc. By virtue of creation, he's a father. In that sense, he's a head of mankind. But besides a natural head, he is also a federal head. Ezekiel Hopkins, by the way, Ezekiel Hopkins is a great Puritan writer, and he wrote a book called The Doctrine of the Two Covenants, and he's always crystal clear, pretty easy to understand. Ezekiel Hopkins says, in this covenant, he was not a single person, but a whole world wrapped up and folded together into one. Natural head and a covenant head. Number two, the Puritans said, to further establish this representative character of Adam, it should be noted that fathers are often made the sureties and trustees for their children. That is to say, in the biblical world, fathers often assume the role of headship and become responsible for their offspring. A parent commonly acted for his children, even for grown children. One of you was telling me the other day how something very big in your life came up, and you bowed, you surrendered in your will to your parents, even though you were a grown adult yourself, and that is expected in your culture. You feel guilty if you didn't do that. That is much easier to understand in many of your cultures than it is in American culture. In American culture, people are taught all their lifetime, unfortunately, to be independent. And as soon as they're 18, you know, they're an adult. They can do their own thing. I had a rude awakening when we took my daughter a few months ago to college. I took out some of my precious time, which I did gladly, drove my daughter all the way out there, sat down in an office with a lady. We had an appointment to talk about her program, to talk about maybe her going to study abroad for 6 months, and I wanted some input in that, of course. I wanted to give her guidance, and the first thing the lady did was gave my daughter a sheet to sign, and then she had to sign in that sheet that she would give permission to this woman that my wife and I could hear their conversation. It's like, you know, is this lady my daughter's parent? And who am I? And so my daughter signs, and I've got to sign, and my wife has got to sign. I'll have this agreement that we can be involved. Because she's 18, she can make her own decisions, you see. This is welcome to America. Well, this is so far from the biblical world. In the biblical world, parents are sureties and trustees. And so this covenant relationship, this idea of representation, is much more, it's easier to get across to the biblical mind and to some of your cultures than it is to the American culture. And often what a father did would impact his children for generations because of this kind of relationship. I'll give you a couple examples here. You've got Abraham in Hebrews 7 paying tithes to Melchizedek. He also represents those who come after him. Genesis 22:16-17, God says to Abraham, because thou hast done this, I'll multiply thy seed, and thy seed shall possess the gates of his enemies. So Abraham actually secures a reward through his obedience for his children and grandchildren. And you can look up 2 Kings 5:26-27 as well. Thirdly, to establish this representative character, we see that in this actual covenant, God dealt only with Adam, only with Adam. Thomas Goodwin said, he could convey sinner guilt no longer time than that he stood as a public person, and when that office and relation was laid down, then he became a private person again, and then sinned for himself alone. That's a common Puritan expression. Adam was a public person. And what that simply means was he represented all mankind, and whatever he did had public ramifications for everyone else. In Adam, 1 Corinthians 15:22, all die. In Adam, all die. So he must have had a representative status. Fourthly, to still establish this point more, God's word seems to say that the doctrine here is that all men have a natural and a covenant union with Adam. And so the Puritans believe that there's a twofold headship of Adam. He's our father, and when he sinned, you see the pollution of his sin was passed on from generation to generation. So from his father headship, we enter this world polluted. But from his covenantal or federal headship, his guilt is imputed to every one of his posterity. So we enter the world guilty and polluted, needing justification to be washed of our sin and sanctification to be made pure from our pollution. So we're impacted by both headships of Adam, the Puritans would say. And then fifthly, the Puritans made much of Romans 5, this point particularly, that the first sin entered into the world of men and death as threatening the covenant works then passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. So the one sin of the one man is accounted to be the sin of all, the Puritans said. And it really doesn't matter if you think you would have done differently than Adam did. Actually, you wouldn't have. But it doesn't matter because he's the representative, you see. And as Thomas Boston said, no one seems to complain that Christ represents us by suffering and dying for us. Nobody says, oh, well, that's not fair, Christ representing me. So no one can say in God's sovereign prerogative, he's the potter, we're the clay, it's not fair that Adam represented us. That's just the way it is. Who art thou, O man, to reply against God? Romans 9. Now, that whole concept of fairness is one that really needs to be addressed today, especially in our society. Everybody thinks they're getting cheated. Everybody thinks they should get more than they deserve. If you really want God to be fair with you, we would all be dead long ago. We'd all be in hell. And our people need to know that. So all this quibbling and squabbling, and that's just the way it is. I woke up one morning and saw the headlines of a newspaper about 20 years ago, or 30 years ago maybe now, 40, I don't know, when I was young, I guess. And it said, United States bombs Libya. Well, I'm a citizen of the United States. I didn't bomb Libya. This isn't fair. No, it's fair. It's not only fair, it's a fact. Because I'm a citizen of this country, and my president represents me just the way it is. And President Reagan gave the okay. It didn't say Reagan bombs Libya. It said United States bombs Libya. I'm a citizen of the United States. I didn't bomb Libya. Yes, you did bomb Libya. Because my president did. He represents me. That's very, very hard to get through the American psyche, the American individualistic psyche. For some of you guys from Asia, it's probably pretty easy because, well, that's just the way you function in your society, which is a much more biblical concept. You're represented by your government. Okay. The last point we need to establish here is that the proof in the Puritan mind, the real proof that Adam represents us all, is the clear contrast in the scriptures to the second Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ, which runs all through that passage. I don't need to read it to you. You know it so well in Romans 5, 12 through 19. George Gillespie, the Scottish Puritan-minded man, said, as if there had never been more men in the world, the Bible speaks of the first Adam and the second Adam, because these two, between them, had all the rest of the sons of men depending upon them, one to our eternal ruin and the other to our eternal salvation. That's the contrast of Romans 5. And it's interesting that Thomas Goodwin makes that even more graphic. This is just a beautiful part in his Man's Guiltiness Before God book, where he talks about these two huge giants. I don't know if you've ever read Gulliver's Travels, where all these little guys are pinning Gulliver down, like thousands of them pinning down his body. Well, what Goodwin does is he paints millions and millions and millions and millions of people, he says, are hanging from the belt of both of these giants. Like the belt has millions of holes on it. And all these little people are hanging. Everyone in the whole world is hanging on one of the two belts. And Goodwin says, when the Holy Spirit comes and regenerates someone, he comes and he takes this little man off of the belt of the first Adam and unhooks him. And he hooks him over in the belt of the second Adam. And what he's doing is something very powerful. He's saying, you are never not represented. You're never just an individual person all on a lone island. You're always represented. You're always hanging on one of two belts, the first Adam or the second Adam. That's the teaching of Romans 5, Goodwin says. And so this whole idea of Adam being our representative to the Puritan mind is just crystal, crystal clear. And then Goodwin goes on, by the way, I got to tell you this too. He asks this question, you know, is this fair? So he says, well, who would you rather have represent you? Would you rather have yourself represent you? You now in your sinful condition, you think you could do better than Adam when Adam was sinless? And in a condition which he had every capability of not falling? What do you say about that? And would you have had an objection that Adam represented you if he had stayed standing and he had secured eternal life for you? Would you have an objection then? Francis Roberts says, he standing, we all stood. He falling, we all fell. Adam stood in that. Him there, the one who did not fail and never could fail, the one who undertook for us, the one who stood for us, by that man's obedience in life and death, many are made righteous. Bless God then for that. Though ruined in the first Adam, we're redeemed by the last Adam, fallen in the first man, we're raised in the second Adam, second man, death by Adam, life by Christ. Praise the Lord. All right, any questions on the parties in the covenant? The condition of obedience. So in this part of the lecture, I want to look at the condition of the covenant of works. Essentially, it was obedience. Some of the Puritans distinguished two things. They said, Adam had to be obedient to two laws. First, he had to be obedient to the moral law, the Ten Commandments. So he had to love God above all, love his neighbors himself all the time. Secondly, he had to be obedient to a positive law, they called it. We might say a special law. A few of them do use the word special, but a special law. That is to say, the particular law, don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So, first, then, they said Adam, from the time of his creation, was under some kind of law. He had to be under a perfect law because he was, at the beginning, a perfect man and given all the qualities needed to stay perfect. So that's the moral law. And it's called by James 1:25, the perfect law of liberty. And that perfect law demanded, thou shalt love the Lord thy God above all thy neighbor as thyself. Now, secondly, that law must have been revealed to Adam in some way that was embedded in his very nature, because he was made in the image of God, which means that in his soul everything was in accord with God, because everything was true righteousness, true holiness. This law, which the Puritans called the law of nature, must have been inscribed in his conscience. Ezekiel Hopkins says, the dictates and promptings of his own nature, being a holy and a righteous nature, dictated and prompted a right course according to God's eternal rectitude and according to God's moral will. Thirdly, this moral law then was in force before the entrance of sin. And therefore, Adam had every ability he needed to remain standing. Fourthly, that law known to Adam held out to him some promise of life. Some promise of life. We'll see that in other contexts, so I'll just mention it here and pass on. And then fifthly, the law under which Adam was placed was later repeated to Israel on Mount Sinai. And there too, life was promised upon condition of obedience, and death was threatened for transgression. And sixthly, the law in the covenant of works really said, do and live. Do and live. But Adam, of course, didn't. And so he sinned. He transgressed the law, and he was condemned for that. And then, seventhly, Christ, the Puritans would say, has done for us what we failed to do. He undid what the first Adam had undone. And that's why Psalm 40 says God's law was in his heart when he came into the world, Psalm 47 and 8, to fulfill all righteousness. I come to do thy will, O my God. Thy law is in my heart. It's a wonderful text to preach on, by the way. Okay, so all of this establishes the condition of obedience to the moral law of God. And there's no reason for Adam not to obey the moral law of God. But then comes this positive law, this specific law. Now, for the Puritan mind, the first thing to say about this is that it arises from God's sovereign will and good pleasure. Okay, the Puritans are very logical, and they make a distinction here. Moral law arises from the necessity of God's nature. So God is holy, God is just, God is good, and therefore from a perfect creature, he cannot expect anything less than or command anything less than Adam to be holy and righteous and good, because he made Adam in his own image. So this is like, may I say it this way reverently? A no-brainer. The moral law is a no-brainer. This is just reflecting God's own character. So the Puritans would say, since the law is just, the moral law is just a transcript of God's own nature, this goes almost without saying that God expects us to obey the moral law. But positive law does not proceed from the nature of God. It proceeds from the express will of God. And so when God says, thou shalt not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, it's not strictly speaking just a moral law. The tree was neither good nor bad in the moral sense. But God in his sovereignty brought it into this condition. So this law proceeds then from the arbitrary will of God. So the second thing the Puritans immediately added all the time to this positive law by which it could be known is that they said positive law can only be known by divine revelation. Moral law we know by nature. It's embedded in our conscience. Positive law we know only by divine revelation. So when God says to Moses at the Red Sea, speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. I command you, Israel, to go forward. That's a positive law. Man, they looked forward and it's just nothing but the Red Sea. They would never have gone forward without the positive law, not by basic moral law. So positive law depends upon express revelation. Thirdly, positive law commands men in a particular circumstance. See, moral law is for all men for all time. Positive law was for a particular occasion in a particular circumstance. God doesn't give us a tree now, does he? He doesn't say there's one tree that you can't eat of in Grand Rapids. I'm saying this reverently. No. This was a positive law for that particular occasion. Ye shall appoint you cities to be cities of refuge for you to fly unto when you accidentally kill someone. Well, that's not a moral law. That's a positive law. We don't have cities of refuge today. So Adam is told, this is my sovereign will. You will not eat of this tree. Which raises the question, the Puritan said, what's the purpose of this positive law? Well, the purpose is there's several purposes. One, it reveals the measure of Adam's submission to God. Adam's natural conscience could not approve it because it wasn't written upon his nature. He had no natural awareness of it. But the test was, are you willing to obey God unconditionally? Secondly, it impressed upon Adam that he was a free agent. God gave him a free choice here. And positive law does that. You can do this, Adam. You can eat of this tree and destroy yourself and destroy your posterity, or you cannot eat of it and you can eventually come to eternal life. You know, we don't know all the reasons why God allowed evil in this world. And the question of philosophers of all ages, whence evil, is a challenging one to understand. And no doubt there's many pieces in this jigsaw puzzle that we'll never get here below. But there are two pieces, I think, that we do know. One reason is God allowed evil in this world to get glory for himself, so that the whole panorama of his attributes could all be glorified. Had there been never any sin, God's justice and righteousness would never have been glorified the way they are. That doesn't take away from the fact that God gets more glory through the conversion of a sinner than through the damnation of a reprobate. He does. But certainly his glory has something to do with the reason why he allowed sin in the world. But secondly, and maybe a more important reason in some ways, is God wanted the crown of his creation to have free agency. And let me explain that. Some of you have thought about this, no doubt, very often. I actually wrestled with this as a teenager, and I still remember the night when all of a sudden I got this insight, and I think I grasped it a little bit, and probably haven't gotten much further ever since. But I have a friend named Derek Thomas. I'll use him as an example. This guy loves his dog like crazy. I mean, he loves his dog. I'm not a dog person, you know. I had a second church. I had, you know, dogs are just, well, I better not get on that kick. But dogs can be miserable, you know. You come over to someone's house and they're sniffing you all over the place. And the guy says, you know, the people say to you, well, you know, don't let him bother you. And you don't let him bother me. The guy's all over the place. So one time I came over, this was a brand new couple in the church, and they said, do you like dogs? Now what did I say? The dog is sniffing me all over the place and rubbing up against me, and do you like dogs?
Not yours.
And I said, well, if he bothers me too much, I'll just give him a boot. And the guy said to his wife afterwards, he said, you know, I really like that man. I really like our pastor. He's a normal human being. He's about ready to kick my dog because he's so frustrated. So he got the dog out of the room. But Derek Thomas is always showing me, brings me a cell phone, always showing me different pictures of his dog. He just loves his dog. And I can't understand it at all. So then he gives a talk one time about loving different things, like loving a plant and then loving a dog and then loving his wife. And he gets going and going. This is at a conference. And but he said, you know, he loved his wife more than his dog, which I was relieved to hear. Because you can be in a higher relationship with your wife than you can be with your dog. See, and that's the point. When you have a dog, and the dog just, you feed it, and the dog kind of habitually just loves you, and the dog's very faithful to you, very faithful, because you meet the dog's needs, and so the dog's always there. The dog never seems to be moody, you know. There's some real advantages, I guess, to having a dog, supposedly. And what happens, you see, is you can only develop your relationship with the dog so far. So God says, I will allow in man the possibility of falling so that man can express freely at a higher level his devotion, his loyalty, his covenant allegiance to me. Now, that's extremely important. We understand that in human relationships. You know, if my next birthday came around and my wife said, look, here's a card and here's a present. I just have to give it to you because it's your birthday. I'd say, well, thank you. I really don't want it. I mean, if that's the way you're going to give it to me, I don't want it. If you feel you have to do it. I want you to be my wife, not just because you signed the paper 25 years ago. I want you to love me because you're freely choosing every day to love me. You see, that's the way God gets glory. When his creature says, Lord, you're so wonderful. I just want to love you just the way you are. And I'm going to change anything about you. You know, sometimes I say that to my wife. I say, you know, I love you so much. I love you just the way you are. I even love your faults the way they are. I don't even want you not to have the faults, because if you didn't have the faults, you wouldn't be who you are. I sort of tease her that way. But I really mean it. I love her so much just the way she is. I don't even want her to change. And when I say something like that, I can just see in her facial expression the love she feels to me back, you see. And this is what God wants his creature to do. Although God is perfect, flawless, he wants us to love him so much, we'd say, Lord, I just want to obey you no matter what, because I just love you exactly the way you are, and I won't change a thing about you if I could possibly change anything about you. And that gives God great glory. So it's a much, much higher level. Now, I need to tell you the denouement quickly here. After Derek Thomas gave this talk, there was a Q&A. And I've been to a lot of conferences in a lot of dozens of countries in the world, and I've never seen anything at any conference that got such sustained laughter for such a period of time as that Q&A. Because Phil Ryken leaned forward in the middle of the Q&A, looked over at Derek Thomas. Phil was on one end, and Derek was on the other, and like five speakers in between. And Phil said, after that, all that talk about that dog, he said, there's one thing I want to know. You say you love your wife more than your dog, but do you bring the dog into your bedroom? And Derek looked over at him kind of sheepishly. And that place just burst out laughing. And then Phil, the laughter died down. Phil said, and Derek, I just need to ask you another question. Do you bring your dog into bed with you? And Derek kind of winced and goes, place just burst out laughing. Get done laughing. And then Phil goes, I just got to ask you one more question. I can't help it, Derek. Do you kiss your dog? And Derek goes, oh. And man, there was like laughter for like two straight minutes. And so Derek's whole point, you know, he was trying to get across, he kind of defeated himself. He's got this love relationship with his dog. Anyway, you had to be there to experience it. All right. So positive law tests the free agency of a man. And that is important in the Puritan mind. Adam is presented with a choice. And that is suitable, said Thomas Goodwin, for a covenant relationship. By the choice, Adam had an opportunity to show his allegiance. Fourth, there is no suggestion of evil, or maybe this is third, no suggestion of evil in this positive law. If God has said, Adam, thou shalt not blaspheme the name of God, said one Puritan, it would have been a suggestion of an evil thought. Or had it been any violation of God's will put in the shape of any of the Ten Commandments, it would have been the suggestion of evil to a creature who had no conception of evil. But that's not the case here. It just was a neutral tree. Fourth, with respect to this law, nothing could be imagined more simple, nothing more easy to understand. It wasn't complicated. Adam couldn't say, well, Lord, you made it so complex. I didn't know what I was doing. I fell through mistake. I didn't appreciate the consequences. No, it was terribly simple. Fifth, God's command was designed, his positive law, was designed to render Adam's obedience, the Puritan said, more conspicuous. If it was such a simple thing, and it was so public a thing, a tree standing in the middle of the garden, Adam's obedience would be obvious, and his disobedience would be obvious if he was inclined to lay hold of the fruit. So obvious obedience or blatant disobedience. So it's a very clear, clear sign. And the last reason the Puritans, not all the Puritans mention this, but some do, why God chose it is that this law reminded Adam that he enjoyed everything he had through the kindness of his Lord and Master. Because God just didn't say, Adam, don't eat of that tree. God said, Adam, you can eat of every tree of this garden except that one. You can eat of thousands of trees. I'm only giving you one tree you can't eat of. So God is showing his kindness even in the forbidden fruit. All right. Finally, now then, about this, about the conditional obedience. Let me just mention a few things the Puritan said about the probationary period. All of them are agreed on this, that there we must assume here that there was a period of trial, a test period, for a couple of reasons. Number one, without it, this could not have been a covenant. You see, a covenant is a conditional promise, and there comes a time when the promise is secured. So there must have been an ending point. And most Puritans won't bite at the temptation of saying exactly how long the ending point is, because the Bible doesn't tell us. Most of them, those who do comment on time length, usually say, probably he didn't stand long. But he at least made it through the seventh day, they will say, because everything was very good at the end of the seventh day. And he was created on the sixth day. Second, although the promise was no part of the law as such, it was attached to the law. The commandment was ordained to life. So there was a promise, which means there must have been a fulfillment at which the time the life would have been granted. And third, if there was not a time for fulfillment, then man's state on earth would have been forever subject to change. And that is uncharacteristic of the nature of God. And fourth, the Puritans often drew on the analogy of the angels. The angels fell, became devils, some of them, and the others did not fall, and they were secured in their position. Angels cannot fall today from heaven. There was a period of time. And so if there was a respect to the angels and their obedience to God in heaven throughout a probationary period that they had, most likely that was true of Adam and Eve as well on earth. Fifth, if there was no probationary period, it would have been possible for others, for Adam to keep on standing, but because people are changeable, maybe someone could have come along after Adam and that person could have fallen, and then what? And then brought confusion and sin into the world. And so they're saying, no, Adam had a short period of time. He was being tested. If he had passed the test, all men in him would not have been able to sin anymore. And sixth, the time came when the threatening was carried out, and we must therefore assume that the time would have come when the promise would have been carried out if he had remained standing. And then seventh, finally, the Lord Jesus confirms all this, said one Puritan, because he himself said in Matthew 19:17, to that legal mind which he was addressing, if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. And really, that's the condition, keeping all the commandments of God. And Jesus did just that for 33 years so that we can be saved. But Adam failed, and we failed in him. That's the dark side of the covenant of works. He was our representative. We lost the battle in him. Some of the Puritans compared it to David and Goliath. David representing Israel, Goliath representing the Philistines, and they came to war, and Goliath stood that day as the head and the representative of the Philistines. And when he was defeated and humiliated in all his self-sufficiency and arrogance, all the Philistines looked upon him and said, our hopes are done. And they fled for their lives. We're undone, we're doomed, they said. And so said Francis Roberts, when Adam stood in the Garden of Eden and the fortunes of the entire race were wrapped up in that man, He standing, we all would have stood. He falling, we all fell. When he fell, we cried out, we perish, we're doomed. But no, the second Adam came. And the covenant of works, broken, paved the way for the covenant of grace. So now we look to the positive side, the promise of eternal life, said Roberts. All right. Any questions about the condition of obedience? Yes.
Just a question about kind of just prior to that, the whole concept of being fruitful and multiplying, does that also constitute something, you know, a positive law? I mean, it's, there's no punishment appended to it. But, you know, just thinking about
Adam too. Yeah, it would have been a positive law. Yeah, it just wasn't part of the covenant establishment.
Yeah. But everybody being in Adam, right? And, you know, had they been fruitful and multiplied and filled the earth.
Yeah.
I don't know, it doesn't say how long it would have lasted, but it kind of seems like that would be a pretty good time to...
To have children.
Well...
It'd be wonderful to have sinless children.
For a time limit or duration for the probationary time.
Yeah.
If they fill the earth.
Just
thinking about children being born and us being born again into Christ.
Yeah. I'm tempted to make some comments about the positive law to continue today in terms of being fruitful and multiplying, especially for Christians, but I'll refrain myself. But. Yeah. Anyway, okay. Let's go. Yep, Peter.
I was wondering whether Puritan also had some text or some part of scripture which they brought up to show that the angels were secured in that position. Do you know about that?
I think they used that text from Jude. I can't quote it exactly. I think verse 7 or something like that. Yeah. All right, let's talk about the penalty and the promise. The penalty is stated very clearly. There's not a lot of debate on that. In the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. But what exactly death means is the debate. Thomas Boston rightly says that the penalty of this covenant in case of disobedience was death, natural death consisting in the separation of the body from the soul, spiritual death and separation of the soul from God, a death in trespasses and sins, and eternal death, separation of both body and soul from God forever in hell. So that's a typical Puritan way of dividing death into its three categories. Natural death, separation of soul and body. Spiritual death, separation of soul from God. Eternal death, separation of soul and body from God's favor forever in hell. And the reason that death is required is because sin is an evil above all that we can think or speak. Every sin is an infinite evil because it's injurious to an infinite God. David Clarkson, who was an associate to the famous John Owen, shared the pulpit with him, said, sin is an offense of infinite majesty, a contempt of infinite authority, an affront to infinite sovereignty, an abuse of infinite mercy, a dishonor to infinite excellency, a provocation to infinite justice, a contrariety to infinite holiness, a reproacher of infinite glory, and an enemy to infinite love. So why shouldn't the penalty be very severe? Jeremiah Burroughs writes a whole book called The Evil of Evils, 350 pages or so, I think, about how dreadful sin is. And one of his propositions is that there is more evil in the least sin than there is in the greatest affliction. Now, the Puritans were very much people that were aware of the sinfulness of sin. And that's one of the great weaknesses of the Christian church today, that we pastors get on the pulpit and try to tell people, I don't want to convict you of sin. I don't want you to go out feeling guilty, but I'm just going to preach to you today. You don't want me to go out and feel guilty? Puritans said, we want to make the unconverted feel very guilty. So guilty, one Puritan said, I want to take the stick of the word and beat behind every bush until I get every atom from behind his bush to stand naked before God. So, what are these three things? Well, first of all, the death of the body. The death of the body. The day thou eatest of, thou shalt surely die. Obviously, that would have been Adam's first understanding. Adam did fall victim, of course, to death, finally, after 930 years. And death would reign from Adam to Moses, and behind everyone's name would be written, and he died, or and she died. But Adam didn't die that day. So Puritans wrestled with that. The day thou eatest of, thou shalt surely die. And most of them resolved it this way. Adam began to die. Dying is a process. And he began to die physically that very day. And so, in your life, in my life, from the day we entered this world, we're dying. We're physically dying. Even if we feel strong and healthy. Secondly, there is this thing we call spiritual death. What the Puritans would say is that that very day, Adam died spiritually. That was the very first extensive fulfillment of the threat. And, of course, you probably know that the Hebrew text literally is, dying thou shalt die. The finite verb is preceded by its own infinitive. And so this denotes certainty. But it also hints at another kind of death. Thou shalt die spiritually. And from that very moment he took that first bite, Adam felt separated from God. Immediately, he had this felt sense of divine wrath and began to hide himself. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. And then, of course, we have that confirmed in Romans 5:18. The Puritans said, by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation. Even so, by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men to justification of life. So the death which overtook Adam is contrasted in Romans 5 to spiritual life that is a result of the second Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ. And then when it comes to eternal death, what the Puritans said is that ultimately this punishment is complete. If there's no repentance and faith in Christ, no salvation, then the result of this sin is what Revelation 20 calls the second death, to die and be cast into hell, ever dying, yet never dead. And every sin really must call for this if it's not washed away. So this is the death of the whole man. 2 Thessalonians 1:7-9 calls it everlasting destruction from the presence of God. So now you see what a fearful thing it was when Adam broke covenant. Physical, spiritual, and eternal death came upon him and upon all mankind. All right, well, what about the promise then? Well, the promise is implied. The promise is not actually spelled out in its concrete terms. Adam had already experienced something of the life that was contemplated, the Puritans say. So he didn't need that promise spelled out that clearly because it was so obvious. There was the tree of life. And God said, that tree of life is a symbol of the promise. And this promise then would have been the life of the body and the life of the soul. Just like the threat was the death of the body and the death of the soul. And the parallels here are complete because as eternal death would be the destruction of soul and body in hell forever, so eternal life is the life of the soul and the resurrected body in the state of glory forever. Francis Turretin put it this way, the received opinion among the Orthodox is that the promise given to Adam was not only of a happy life to be continued in paradise, but a heavenly and eternal life. If Adam had kept his part of the covenant, it is just to suppose that when Adam's posterity had filled the earth in the mystery and wonder of God, all mankind would have been translated to heaven as Enoch was, not tasting death. Life was held out to perfect obedience. So, one of the Puritans put it this way, how great a matter is involved here. Upon Adam all depends. If he sins, death. If he obeys, life. Angels watch. Satan enters the garden, deceives the woman. The man takes the fruit, follows his wife in transgression. Is it thus a matter of merely taking some fruit from a tree? No. 'Tis far, far worse than that. 'Tis the taking of death. 'Tis the dropping of life. Angels stand aghast. Adam has not just pivoted himself into an abyss, but the whole human race. The race hangs upon his coattails. It drags down with him. On that day, a human race was lost. One of the old Scottish Puritan preachers put it like this. Here was a vessel at sea. The pilot at the helm was foolish Adam. He stands and steers the craft, and all of the human race is on board. And foolish man, he steers the vessel right to the rocks. All are thrown into the sea of wrath. All face death. Oh, look yonder, another vessel. At the helm of the pilot is the Son of God. That vessel is the covenant of grace. Upon Christ all the elect depend. All are within that vessel. See him steer it. He steers an even course. Unlike Adam, he obeys to the last. Jesus Christ the righteous. He steers the vessel into the calm waters of God's eternal peace. And as the ship draws near to where the first ship went down, where the covenant of works was broken and all was lost, the Lord hails to safety the perishing in the water and says, put your trust in me. Come into the safety of the other vessel, the covenant of grace, and all who believe in Christ are saved from perishing, snatched from the angry waves of God's sore indignation and damnation, saved by another head, another representative, who unlike the first did not fail but kept the law, made it honorable, brought life to all for whom he had responsibility in the covenant of grace. Well, the hand of the helmsman is stretching out to the perishing under your preaching, brother. And you're to call them to grasp that hand, that mighty hand to save, and to come into the blessing of the covenant of grace. May that thrill your heart as you preach it. And may it thrill your hearts of your people as they receive it. Bless God for the second Adam, our Redeemer. Now, there's one more area to cover before we move into the covenant of redemption, and that is the area of the sacramental seals of the true trees in the garden. I'll just cover that briefly. You've got the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which is a confirmation of the promise. Because it's the tree of the knowledge of good, first of all, said one Puritan. What did that mean? What did it teach Adam? Well, it meant that to teach him that he had no ultimate good in himself. It was a tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So this tree had pleasant fruit indeed. It was good for food. It was pleasant to the sight. But it also held forth spiritually what was evil. So, in a sense, the tree of knowledge of good and evil was a reminder to Adam of the good things of God as well as the evil that he could possibly fall into. But the tree of life in the midst of the garden was also a gift of God. And it indicated what would be the satisfaction of man, that is, life. And Francis Roberts said, the very leaves of that tree must have reminded Adam of the promises of God. And that fruits of the tree must have reminded him of the pleasures of God. Upon his obedience, he would live. And that life would be enjoyed constantly. Because the tree of life was continually before him in the garden. It wasn't a passing thing. It wasn't on the edge of the garden. It wasn't a cloud that appeared and then disappeared. It was visible all the time. All the time he was under probation, as the life it signified would be continuous and even everlasting. But of course, Adam failed and destroyed mankind. And death passed upon all men. And then finally, in conclusion, the Puritans said, there is no possibility of renewing the covenant of works. The covenant of works had been one of friendship. It was a covenant of amity, but now man has become an enemy and cannot be restored through this covenant. The terms are impossible. The perfect obedience demanded has been spoiled. Who can bring a clean thing out of an unclean? Man is now under a curse, so there is no more hope, no more possibility under the covenant of works. And the way to paradise is now blocked up. The angels, the flaming sword, the cherubim, guard the way from the tree of life. Even God cannot renew this without violating his own character. Thomas Boston put it this way: Adam was constituted a public person representing us in the first covenant, the ship whereof he was made steersman, being split. The covenant of grace is another ship came up of which Christ was the steersman. This covenant was led out on a rope to hail the passengers to land. Sort of the same thought as the Francis Roberts, only in shorter compass. All right, any questions on the covenant of works? Yes. Yeah. The Puritans would say that what God has done in the second Adam is to restore that image as well. In perfection, in Christ, as the Heidelberg Catechism says so beautifully in Lord's Day 23, question 60, that when Christ's righteousness is received for that sinner who's completely unworthy and hell-worthy, then it is as if we have never sinned, because we are now in the righteousness of Christ, and then we become prophets, priests, and kings again, which is really the essence of the image of God: prophet, knowledge, priest, righteousness, king, holiness. Those three are restored to us in Christ. And then you go to Lord's Day 12, question 31 and 32. What does his name Christ mean? He's our chief prophet and our only priest and our eternal king. But why art thou, question 32, called the Christian? And then the answer is, because now I'm a partaker of Christ, so I'm a confessor of his name, prophet. And it goes on to say, I've been restored as a priest. I confess and deny something. And then I desire to rule over him, over all his enemies. I'm a king. So God gets his image back through the second Adam when his people receive that second Adam by faith and become prophets, priests, and kings again. They stay imperfect, but they're viewed by God in Christ and his righteousness as perfect. And then one day in glory, that image will be completely, perfectly restored also in them. So there'll be perfect prophets, perfect priests, and perfect kings, and God will have his own image completely back in his people in perfection. Not only in Christ, but now in perfection in them. All right. Let's begin the covenant of redemption and the covenant of grace, because I've had to do so much groundwork with the covenant of works. It won't take me quite as long. So I want to jump in for 20 minutes, and I'll let you go then on time tonight, and we'll continue on Wednesday. But I want to say a few things about the covenant of redemption by way of introduction. Scripture speaks of this covenant. In many places, more than most people first realize, not just in Zechariah 6, verse 13, the counsel of peace shall be between them, that is, between the Father and the Son. That, of course, is the classic text, and therefore it's often called the covenant of redemption or the counsel of peace, or the other names as well, but some Puritans would therefore say, because of all this scriptural support, we'll get into some of the texts later, about a dozen texts, because of the scriptural support, the covenant of redemption between the Father and the Son is a different covenant in the covenant of grace. They all agree there's a close connection between the two. And that a lot of them will say something like this: the covenant of grace is the working out in time of the foundational covenant of redemption from eternity. But this is where you get into this debate. Are there two covenants or are there three covenants? Covenant of works being one of them, covenant of grace being another. Is the covenant of redemption then a third covenant? Or is the covenant of redemption really one with the covenant of grace? We just call it by another name because it's the eternal dimension of that covenant. And a lot of people think this is just a huge, huge issue, whether you call it three covenants or whether you call it two covenants. Some Puritans believed in three covenants. Some spoke of it as one covenant, essentially, which had an eternal aspect and a temporal aspect, which I would probably lean to that position, and that there's only one saving covenant. I'll give you a few reasons why, but as I do, I want to stress with you this, that as long as you don't put any human merit into the three covenant view, that man is accomplishing something by himself apart from grace, there's not really as much difference as has often been made out to be between those views. Some people, also my background, thought it was a huge question, because if you admitted three covenants, they thought you were going back to Arminius, because he supported three covenants, and they even said that he was the first one to do so. Well, he wasn't the first one to do so by any means. Many of our sound forefathers made a distinction. But if you say, I believe in three covenants, it's important that you can say also that you believe that the covenant of grace is totally the grace of God to you. See, here's the problem. If you say the covenant of redemption, covenant of grace are separate, and the covenant of redemption is made between the Father and the Son as the two parties, and then the covenant of grace is made between the Father representing the Trinity and the Son, The covenant of grace is made between the triune God as one party and God's people or God's visible church, some would say, as a second party. And you don't include Christ anywhere over here in this equation. Then the problem is that you make man responsible for fulfilling the conditions of the covenant, and fickle man can never do that. And this lends itself to free will, free grace over time. Free will rather than free grace over time. And that's the danger of the three covenant system, that it can, when not rightly taught, lead eventually to man thinking he must accomplish something in his own strength, rather than the free grace of God. Okay? Now, many of the Puritans who believed in three covenants and who actually said the two parties are the triune God and the people of God or the visible church, stressed with that God's people could never fulfill the conditions without Jesus Christ. So that Jesus Christ really is their head in that covenant. In one way or another, they would say that, even though if they put it on the paper, it didn't look that way. Okay? So what other Puritans said was this, that the covenant of grace was really made between the Father representing the Trinity and Jesus Christ, the head of the elect. Now, this safeguards more clearly than this that meaning the conditions of the covenant are totally dependent upon Jesus Christ because he represents us and we do it in him and he gives us the grace to do it. So that seems to be very scriptural and seems to be very, very helpful. The danger of this, or according to people who believe this, is that if you just say, oh, well, Jesus Christ does it all for me, that it seems to downplay my responsibility to be actively involved in the covenant myself, to actually be striving to fulfill the conditions. People, however, who believe this say, well, that's just an abuse of this. We actually believe strongly that the elect must be actively involved. God's 100% sovereign in his grace. We're 100% responsible. Now, this is a safer scenario theologically. So there are these little different emphases. But you can maintain both. And I know that in this seminary, of course, you know, the Free Reformed and the Heritage Reformed both have men on the board of trustees. Free Reformed traditionally embracing the three covenant view, and the Heritage Reformed traditionally embracing the two covenant view, although I'm not sure how many ministers have really studied both in depth. A few have. But the Free Reformed certainly would maintain the emphasis on Christ, and the Heritage Reformed certainly would maintain the responsibility of men. And so we can come together and we can actually teach this course together in one course and recognize that both views are within the pale of Reformed orthodoxy and not call each other heretics or any other such thing. Okay? So really, some certain people who don't know the issues very well can try to drive a wedge between the two and say there's a substantial difference. But I would argue that there's not a substantial difference unless we fall into one of these two errors of excising Christ from here and not maintaining responsibility over here. Okay? So I'm going to flesh it out for you a bit. That's just an introductory thought to help you along as we look at this. So there are Puritans who actually believe this way, and you think they believe then in three covenants, but they'll actually say even then, but really it's just a covenant from eternity and a covenant in time, and there's just different parties involved, but it's really the same essential covenant. So are they two covenant people or are they three covenant people? We don't know. So ultimately, the responsibility of man and the sovereignty of God's grace, if those two things are maintained, whether it's two or three, doesn't really matter. In fact, you can read the Westminster Standards, and you actually don't, at the end, you don't even know. Like, Westminster Larger Catechism seems one way, and Westminster Confession seems another. The two different groups of men that wrote them, well, in a way, but the two and three wasn't the big deal. The big deal was maintaining God's sovereignty and man's responsibility. And so, but you did have difference of emphases here. But the best Puritans certainly maintained that there is an eternal aspect to the covenant of grace, and whether you call it covenant of grace, you call it covenant of redemption, counsel, peace, doesn't matter. And there's a temporal aspect to the covenant of grace where it's worked out in time. But having said that, then, I would maintain that there's only one saving covenant. And I would see it from eternity and in time for a couple of reasons here. Number one, since man's misery came by one covenant, we might expect, said a number of Puritans, that his salvation would come by one covenant. That's the point made by Adam Gibb. In his Sacred Contemplations, he says, as man's ruin is by one covenant, his recovery is likewise by one covenant. God is but one salvation, one way of saving sinners by Jesus Christ. Second reason for believing in one covenant of salvation is that the remedial covenant is always referred to in the singular in the Bible as one covenant. David, for example, speaks in 2 Samuel 23 as having an everlasting covenant ordered in all things. And sure, he doesn't say, I was saved by two covenants ordered in all things. And sure. Zechariah 9, verse 11, speaks of the deliverance of lawful captives through the blood of the covenant, singular. And Hebrews 13, 20 speaks of the everlasting covenant, singular. Third reason for believing that there's but one remedial or saving covenant is that there are only two covenants relating to eternal life. There's lots of covenants in the Word of God, but only two that relate to eternal life. And Paul refers to them in Galatians 4:24. He says, these things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants. And he's referring there to the covenant of works. I'm sorry. Yeah. Not the covenant of works. He's referring there to the Mosaic covenant, along with its sanctions and penalties, which had a form of works to it in some sense. We'll talk about that later, at least to drive men to the covenant of grace, and the covenant of grace. There's not a third covenant that he surfaces here. John Brown, in his famous work, his famous systematic theology, John Brown of Headington, said, there's no reason why the new covenant should be split into two more than to assert that a covenant of works was made with Adam and another with his seed. Well, that it was a covenant of works with Adam the head, and then there was a covenant of works made with humanity, that's one and the same covenant. And the point Brown is making, helpfully, is that there's one covenant which respects the new covenant head and all that he represents as well. So Scripture, therefore, speaks of the establishing of this covenant in eternity, and then establishing it in time. And it speaks of this covenant as being made with the Son. Galatians 3:17. The covenant which was confirmed before of God in Christ. And then God takes that covenant he's made with his Son and he makes it with his people through his Son. 2 Samuel 23, verse 5. And we don't have to wrestle with that. How can that be reconciled? God makes a covenant then with his people. It's the temporal manifestation of what was laid from eternity. So God, from eternity, has a counsel of peace with his Son, and he then works it out and applies it to his people. There's a oneness of design here that God has in mind. Now, that's the basic concept then. Its beginnings are from eternity, and its basic features are three. Now, this is B2 now. That it is divine, eternal, and gracious. Divine, eternal, and gracious. Christ meets all of its conditions, and therefore it's a divine covenant, and Jesus Christ, therefore, is the center, both on God's side and from man's side. And we are just deeply indebted to Christ and every step of the way for what he has done to make this covenant real. Secondly, this covenant is eternal. It's manifested in God from eternity past. And that's pure grace. He's established it from the stillness of eternity. And thirdly, it's always a gracious covenant. It's always one-sided between the Father and the Son, working it out and then sending it our way. In his condescending grace. So, Jesus meets all the conditions, the condition of obedience, the condition of holiness of nature, the conditions of suffering unto death, and then he graciously applies it to us. Now, the real issue in the covenant of redemption then is, what exactly do the Father and the Son say to each other and agree with each other and promise each other and reward each other? What is the actual exchange? And that's what we'll have to get into on Wednesday then, because our time is up. Point B3, we'll look at the essence of this covenant. All right. We will shut down for the night. And whose turn is it to pray? Will you pray with us, brother?
Thank you, Father, for